He played it with dignity, with honor and grace, both the game of life and politics. Blessed with great beauty of person, the jealous gods robbed him of one gift, the gift of time. Between two eternities, just 46 summers. Too few to fulfill those plans and dreams. Too few for one so faithful. Over 4,000 years ago, in 2500 BC, the game Chaturang was invented in India. Over the centuries, it evolved into Shatranj, the royal game of chess. A game of strategy and skill, of ingenuity and guile. This ancient game is still played in modern India. The battlefield is the Indian political arena. The pursuit is power. The consequences, history.
Friends, the people have given their verdict. In all humility, we respect the verdict. A new government will be formed. We extend to them our good wishes and offer them our constructive cooperation.
Rajiv Gandhi, Prime Minister of India, grandson of Jawaharlal Nehru, India's first Prime Minister, who ruled India for 17 years. 2 years after Nehru's death, his only child, Indira Gandhi, acquired the mantle of Prime Minister and grew into a formidable leader, dominating the Indian political scene for the next 17 years. After Indira's assassination in 1984, her only surviving son, Rajiv, a 40-year-old airline pilot, but a novice in politics, was given a massive mandate to lead India as Prime Minister, perpetuating a unique saga of dynasty through democracy. Rajiv was the third generation of the House of Nehru, which has run India for 39 of its 44 years of independence. In the public mind, Rajiv's 5 years in office were divided into two distinct phases, 1985 and 1986, the years of breakthroughs and progress, 1988 and 1989, the years of growing disillusionment. It was in this charged atmosphere that Rajiv Gandhi belied expectations and called for a general election on 22nd November 1989. On one side was the beleaguered Congress Party, offering a stable government but with a battered public image. On the other side, a fractured opposition rivened by differences of ideology. In India's electoral arithmetic, the Congress I has always received an average of 43% of the vote. The remaining 57% was distributed over several other parties. A fragmented opposition was unable to exploit this to its advantage. But By 1989, the scenario had changed. Vishwanath Pratap Singh, the Raja of Manda, a small princely state in Uttar Pradesh, came into national prominence as Rajiv Gandhi's finance minister. He resigned in April 87 as defense minister, and immediately after, the first reports of the Bofors scandal appeared. Dubbed a traitor, VP Singh was expelled from the Congress in July 87. Singh joined up with Rajiv's political opponents, all ex-Congress I members, and formed the Jan Morcha. VP Singh was a creation of the Indian media. India loves saints, and the press created a halo of sacrifice and saintliness around him. On August the 6th, 1988, the assorted collection of seven regional parties coalesced around Singh to form the National Front. In their common goal of ousting Rajiv Gandhi, the opposition knew that this was the make or break moment to bring the Congress party down with a one-to-one fight. So, the National Front forged electoral pacts with communists and Hindu fundamentalists to fight 490 parliamentary seats from one platform. Prime Minister Gandhi's trusted minister, Vishwanath Pratap Singh, chalked out a war strategy. His target? Rajiv's right-hand man now became his arch-rival. It was a cliffhanger of an election. The results were puzzling. Out of 529 seats in Parliament, Rajiv got 193. VP got 142. The Congress had lost the election. The opposition had not won it either. It was a hung Parliament. As the leader of the largest party, Rajiv was invited by the President of India to form a government. Rajiv declined and submitted his resignation. Looking at the final results, what was the electorate trying to say?
Fundamentally, I feel that the electorate in the November 89 elections was saying that they were not, well, happy enough with the rate of progress of development, and that the government was still too procedure bound, too many forms, too many hassles. And well, what I'm saying in a nutshell is not enough change. But my gut feeling is that it's not that. It's something much deeper than that. The electorate seems to give about 3 years, 4 years before it gets fed up of the government it gets in. There's a deep frustration somewhere in the system which needs to be released.
I think they were sending out a very strong warning to Rajiv. And the warning was, look, we gave you a massive mandate 5 years ago, and you've squandered it. We still think you're a good bet, but you jolly well learn the tricks of the trade, and you be in the opposition for a while. Let's see what happens.
Where did Rajiv's government go wrong?
The first is the Bofors issue. I think the whole problem was mismanaged from the word go.
I have to agree with that. We didn't handle the Bofors issue at all well. We lost credibility right at the beginning. And, what we felt so, helpless about was that here we thought we were on good ground. We had done a very good contract. We'd got it at a very low rate. And that's why we opened up and said that we'll have an inquiry, we'll do this, and we were quite frank. But the more frank we were, the more of a mess we got into.
The second was the flip-flops on the way they dealt with the Ram Temple controversy.
No, I don't agree at all with that. We had a very clear line on that issue, and that was that we would go entirely by what the court said. There was a part of the land which included the mosque which was disputed, and we very categorically said that there would be no shilanyas on that part of, on that land. While it was quite all right to have a shilanyas outside that area, we got the UP administration to mark a spot which was outside, and perhaps most important, which was missed, was that we got the VHP and the BJP to sign a document saying that they will only have the shilanyas outside the disputed area and they will not start an agitation or try to construct the temple.
he really went wrong in the pre-election politicking. He couldn't really prevent the opposition parties from getting together. And once they got together and they sort of formed a united front against him, I think three quarters of the act was over.
I agree. We allowed them to unite. Perhaps sometimes we helped them to unite.
I think he presented to the electorate a distant figure who had lost touch with the ambitions and aspirations of the majority of the Indian electorate. I went to many meetings, was astounded by the level of security, by the physical distance that the then Prime Minister put between himself and the large crowds.
One of the problems with being Prime Minister was the ring of security. And while when I was Prime Minister, I thought that we were able to break out of it sufficiently at times. Now, in the period when I was not, I could get a better idea of how solid that ring really was.
Commentators suggest that there was a dichotomy in Rajiv as a Prime Minister and as a politician.
As Prime Minister, conducting himself as a statesman, he certainly succeeded on several foreign fronts. He also succeeded to a very large extent in projecting an image of a modern India, of a dynamic India, of an India on the go. As a politician, however, he simply couldn't bring himself to indulging in the kind of maneuverings, the manipulations, the low cunning that is required. And I think this failing of his hampered his job as the Prime Minister.
Oh, I'm sure it did. But I'm not unhappy at it. I wouldn't like to be doing all those things. I don't know. I mean, even if I had to really think about it, I don't think I'd become manipulative and scheming. It's not me.
I think Rajiv Gandhi as a Prime Minister performed extremely well on certain fronts, particularly in areas that didn't require political maneuvering. Things like the economy, things like law and order, things that required simple decisions. Anything that required understanding which politician to rely on, where to get loyalty from, I think he failed miserably on that. His assessment on people and on particularly on politicians was particularly poor.
I don't disagree too much with him. You must remember that I came into politics only in 81. And my knowledge of the people is limited to just those years. And I've not known the people, their reliability factor under certain conditions for an adequate period.
He's very good at being Prime Minister. He looks good. He fits the part. He has all the confidence that his family background and his limited training have given him in that role. On the world stage, in international conferences, he looks very much not just a national leader, but an international leader. He speaks easily and with poise and confidence to other world leaders of great stature. As a politician, I think his inexperience shines out. And I think throughout his time as the head of Congress, he has showed an uncanny ability to acquire the wrong sort of friends and heed the wrong sort of advice.
Sometimes it's been said that I rely on a coterie, I rely on a particular group of people, and it's not the best advice they give. But it's actually not true. Normally, what the media projects as the people I rely on are not really the people I'm relying on, but they're the people who project themselves as people whom I rely on.
By garnering support of the BJP and the left parties, the National Front achieved an arithmetical majority and came into power. The making of the new Prime Minister was straight out of an action-packed thriller. Following 3 days of postponements, on 1st December, the Janata Party convened to elect its leader and the next Prime Minister of India. The result was not a foregone conclusion. The contenders for the lead role were now two: VP Singh and his bete noir, Chandrasekhar. In the last 48 hours, Shekhar had declared that he would not back VP, but would compete with him in the race for prime ministership. Arun Nehru, the mastermind, and others swung into action. They prevailed on Shekhar to withdraw his candidature, as not VP, but Shekhar's own man, Devi Lal, would be elected prime minister, and Chandrasekhar would be deputy prime minister. Shekhar agreed, and the deal was struck.
After a few minutes, you'll know.
The next 15 minutes would reveal the dexterity of political brinkmanship.
Decision was taken to choose Devi Lal. VP Singh to propose, myself to second.
The scene went according to the script, and Devi Lal was declared elected. The news services flashed the report, and then the bombshell burst. Devi Lal declined and nominated VP Singh. As if on cue, Ajit Singh promptly seconded it. And the drama was over. Vishwanath Pratap Singh was Prime Minister.
It was altered at the last moment without my knowledge, without consent, without information.
Outmaneuvered and betrayed, Chandrasekhar strode out, perhaps to fight another day.
I told you there'd be no problem.
On December the 2nd, the 58-year-old Raja Vishwanath Pratap Singh finally wore the crown which he had repeatedly said he did not want. Like his mother and grandfather before him, Gandhi became a symbol of his party, the leader of the world's largest political organization in a democracy. The Congressi, which consists of more than 25 million members, is also one of the oldest political parties in the world, going back 105 years.
And we've had a number of problems in the Congress with all sorts of things. But under the severest strain in 87, during the president's election, during the whole Bofors controversy, in 89 when we lost the election, and then following that up to today, the Congress has remained strong and united, and nobody except for four or five people have left the Congress. Now compare that with what has happened to the other political parties. They've just broken up into splinters, aligned, realigned, and realigned again. So although there have been weaknesses, there is a tremendous strength in the Congress also.
Rajiv's detractors predicted that after the Congress defeat, the party would split. Rajiv proved them wrong.
I know the strength of the Congress when it is in power, and I know that the Congress is doubly strong when it is sitting on the opposition benches.
And so began the new campaign, that of Rajiv Gandhi, leader of the opposition.
After we lost the last election, one of the first priorities for us was to put our party organization in order, and we started this series of tours which involved traveling mostly on train, second class, which meant that you were with the people, you felt what they felt, you were amongst them, you got the warmth that they gave you, the tremendous affection they gave. Sometimes we discussed things, for example, often I would have students in the same compartment who would have questions. I remember one occasion we had a long discussion about reservations and the pros and cons of reservations, the other things that were required.
But I think from the very start, Rajiv Gandhi knew that his exile wouldn't last very long and that he might as well use the time that he had in the opposition to renew his contact with the masses. And if he does come back to power, it is because each time he appears in public, even in territory which was hostile to him only a few months ago, he's now welcomed with a warmth and effusiveness that is remarkable.
Meanwhile, within 6 months of being in power, VP Singh's honeymoon with the press and the public appeared to be over.
Your stand on this is absolutely dubious.
VP Singh's government was castigated for soaring prices and for non-performance on major national issues.
The National Front government couldn't do a thing about any of the burning issues before the nation, and they couldn't do that primarily because they didn't have a policy.
Resignation and withdrawals, intrigues and vacillations marked Singh's tenure. The National Front government tossed from crisis to crisis. Caught between competing factions and personal rivalries in his beleaguered coalition government, on August 1st, Prime Minister Vishwanath Pratap Singh sacked his earlier mentor and guide, the Deputy Prime Minister Devi Lal. And the die was cast. Being out of power made little difference to Gandhi's daily schedule, which remained as hectic as ever, starting with the morning darshan at 9 a.m. As Prime Minister, Gandhi had about 300 security men shadowing his every movement. Now, for the man who survived two assassination attempts, only three of those remained. Gandhi consults with political leaders during the day. Vincent George, who joined Indira Gandhi 15 years ago as a stenographer, remains Rajiv's faithful private secretary. Free moments are brief and rare. Finally, at 1 in the morning, the day comes to an end. The Raja had counted on dramatic revelations on Bofors that would destroy Rajiv Gandhi's political career.
I shall recall that Mr. V.P. Singh promised the electorate that within 15 days of his becoming Prime Minister, he would reveal the names.
These were not forthcoming, despite unrelenting attempts made by his government.
V.P. Singh went about the Bofors issue in a very vindictive and personalized way. But still, he didn't really achieve anything. And if I remember rightly, at Patna once he said that he has my Swiss bank account number. And then at some public meetings he dipped into his pocket and fished out a paper and said, I've got it here. In 30 days, they will have a result. Nothing.
So, a new issue had to be found. Knowing the Allies would not let him survive a full term and internal tensions would pull the party apart anyway, V.P. Singh prepared for a midterm election. He decided to recast himself as a champion of the backward classes, which constitute 52% of the population. Overnight, on August the 7th, he introduced a legislation of a report published in 1980 by Bindeshwari Prasad Mandal to enforce the reservation of 27% of all jobs in government and public sector enterprises for citizens belonging to the 3,000 caste groups designated other backward classes, in addition to the 22.5% already reserved for the scheduled castes and tribes, making a total of 49.5% reservations.
We feel that reservations are necessary in some areas, but they must be backed up by other action. Most important is education. It's no use having reservations if people can't get educated to fill those reservations.
The basis for caste enumeration was the census data gathered by the British in 1891 and 1931.
I feel that V.P. Singh chose to implement the Mandal report not because he felt that the backward classes needed reservations or needed special help. He chose to follow up on the Mandal report because he was threatened by an immediate controversy. He had dismissed Mr. Devi Lal. Mr. Devi Lal was holding massive rallies, and he needed something to see that the UP chief minister and the Bihar chief minister did not join Mr. Devilal. And he fished the Mandal Commission out of the bag.
The decision to implement the recommendations of the Mandal Commission report resulted in public outrage. And widespread condemnation by the press.
I was told that when the report was taken, when the action paper was taken to him by the officers involved, they pointed out to him that if this is implemented, there will be a lot of bloodshed. And I believe his response was, when you want change, you have to shed blood. It's very unfortunate.
The most seriously affected were the students, already facing the prospects of unemployment. The total number of educated unemployed persons in the country is about 50 million, out of which 10.5 million are unemployed graduates. Despairing of their future, they martyred themselves through a series of self-immolations.
It just shows the sort of frustration this brought into the younger generation, the sort of bleakness that they saw in their future. They saw it just disappearing from in front of them. And well, the sad part is that Mr. V.P. Singh didn't even, well, it just didn't, he didn't see it.
It's quite likely that, you know, he didn't care. What is it if 10, 15, 40 kids burn themselves when you can constitute a vote bank of 52% of the population?
Nehru brought in legislation in the constitution abolishing caste discrimination, and a whole new generation has emerged unaware of caste conflicts. With the Mandal Commission report, discrimination and casteism, which was dying, was once again being rekindled and ignited.
Where do we go from here? We think of ourselves as Brahmins, Thakurs, Jats, Yadavs, and so on and so forth. And we shed blood to uphold our narrow and selfish denominators. We are imprisoned by the narrow domestic walls of religion, language, caste, and region, blocking out the clear view of a resurgent nation. Is this the India for which Mahatma Gandhi and Indira Gandhi sacrificed their lives?
India has defined itself as a secular state because it wanted to keep religion out of the state. The state has no religion. The state must look after people of every faith.
India has traditionally been a very tolerant country, a country where different thoughts, different cultures have mixed. There's been synthesis, there's been absorption. All the best has been taken, the worst has been rejected. That is what has given us strength, and secularism is the key to that.
The continuance of India as a secular nation, even after its religionist dismemberment in 1947, remains one of the world's noblest experiments with modernism.
And I feel that India is a tiny, what should I say, test piece for future society. Democracy demands that you allow people their own ways while they live together under one umbrella. Secularism is one clear aspect of that. If secularism is not to work or is to be discarded, then not only does India fall apart, the whole test, the example that we are setting for the world, breaks down. On the immediate effects, if secularism is abandoned, we'll have very large-scale bloodshed in the country. Our country will break up into more pieces.
The issue that has caused the most headlines for the last 4 years and the downfall of two governments is the Babri Masjid, a 426-year-old mosque built by the Mughal Emperor Babur in the town of Ayodhya, 300 miles east of Delhi. Muslims revere it as one of the oldest mosques in the country, but Hindus claim it is located on the birthplace of one of their most widely worshipped deities, Ram. The right-wing fundamentalist party, the BJP's major platform, was to demolish the Babri Mosque and construct a temple in its place.
Today, even the BJP claims it's secular. And I can see no bigger hypocrisy than that. For us, secularism means not a non-religious country. It means a religious country, but with full freedom for each religion to develop, to propagate, to prosper. And I feel very strongly that secularism is the only way for India.
India has a population of over 700 million Hindus and 120 million Muslims. Almost all religious riots since 1986 have been linked to Ayodhya, which ironically means a place of no wars. The National Front's major ally, the BJP, felt threatened by VP Singh's sudden decision to implement the Mandal Commission. By luring the other backward classes, Singh was splitting the BJP's vote bank, comprising mainly of Hindus. This galvanized the BJP into action. A DCM Toyota was converted into a chariot, and the BJP leader, L.K. Advani, embarked on a Rath Yatra, or chariot procession. A 10,000-kilometer, five-week religious caravan was to culminate in Ayodhya on October the 30th to begin the building of the temple.
I think the Rath Yatra of Mr. Advani was quite literally a bandwagon. It almost visibly attracted votes as it rolled across North India. It was a political, nakedly political demonstration. The party's symbol was painted prominently on the sides of his so-called chariot. And the BJP, by identifying itself with the temple movement, I think has very shrewdly, some would say very cynically, exploited the communal and religious fervour which is now so much part of Indian life, particularly in the north.
The focus of the BJP campaign is the creation of a Hindu Rashtra, or Hindu nation.
So far they've been content with using certain Hindu signs, Hindu slogans and Hindu symbols, Hindu colors. But beyond that, there is no other ideology than one which can be spelled out in three words: resentment of the minorities. And in their scheme of things, if they are able to impose their vision of a Hindu nation, you can be sure that 100 million people in this country will overnight become second great citizens.
What we want is that religion and politics are separated. Because religion and politics mix, the mixture is explosive. Not just for India, it's explosive for anybody, anywhere on the globe. And we see that happening wherever religion and politics have mixed.
For 4 weeks, the procession continued unabated. Just 7 days before it reached Ayodhya, on 23rd October, Singh's government arrested Advani, and the BJP promptly withdrew support. With that, Singh's government lost its majority, but the Raja demanded a vote of confidence in Parliament. The Parliament debate exposed Singh's dealings with both the Hindu fundamentalists and the Muslims.
There was an understanding with the government, and the understanding was that Advani ji will be allowed to complete his Rath Yatra.
To the Muslims, VP Singh claimed he was wholly in sympathy with their stand. At 10:25 p.m. on November the 7th, 1990, just 11 months after assuming office, Vishwanath Pratap Singh was rejected as Prime Minister by an overwhelming majority. It was the first time that a Prime Minister was voted out on the floor of Parliament. Mr. V.P. Singh assumed office through last-minute intrigue and deception. The very same factors were at work when he stepped down on 7th November. In that sense, his personal career had come full circle. The moment Chandrasekhar had been waiting for had finally arrived. In a renewed bid for power, Shekhar split from VP Singh's party with one-third of the party's legislators to form his own Janata Dal socialist faction. For the second time, Gandhi declined the president's invitation to form the government.
Well, I had said in 89 that we don't want to make a government without a mandate. And nothing had changed adequately in 1990. For us to change that position.
With only 56 seats in the 524-member lower house of parliament, Shekhar was propped up by the 212-seat support of Rajiv's Congress party.
Chandrasekhar.
And so, Chandrasekhar, 63, became India's 8th Prime Minister.
Chandrasekhar, unlike many of the other leaders in India, has never been a mass leader. He's been always a backroom party manipulator.
Chandrasekhar, as a politician, is a difficult man to judge. After all, he has been in opposition of one kind or another, more or less throughout his career. He is a natural opposer. He tends not to fit in with any party establishment very well. He is a man who does not find it very easy to trust his colleagues, let alone his rivals. And therefore, he has come into the prime ministership, his first political job of any consequence in the administrative sense, as with a reputation as a loner, as an outsider, who has nevertheless been extremely ambitious.
Political pundits forewarned of dangers to the alliance.
Looking back at November 1990, I didn't think that we would have any really serious problems with Mr. Chandrasekhar and his government. But as things progressed, we found that there were serious policy differences between us. There was almost no contact or communication or consultation on issues. I don't think we had a working relationship. That's the problem. I think we met for serious discussions on perhaps two occasions. That's all.
It was in this period of opposition that Rajiv Gandhi was seen to emerge as a mature politician.
I think Rajiv is now becoming a much cleverer politician. I think he's becoming a much more natural politician. Earlier on, there was a clear distinction between Rajiv, the individual, and what he wanted to do as an individual, and this frustration of having to use politics to do it and having to compromise. I think that's merging together. I think he can do more now as a politician because he's better at the game.
Two guards were caught spying outside Mr. Rajiv Gandhi's residence. The Congress party protested and boycotted Parliament, demanding a political inquiry. Mr. Chandrasekhar resigned as Prime Minister.
It was very sad because we didn't want to topple the government. We right through maintained that we are supporting the government. We were very upset at the breach of faith that had been shown. Because by putting surveillance on me and the Congress office, it showed that they didn't trust us. And it wasn't just a question of two constables. It was a question of a whole cell consisting of over 40 people running a clandestine radio network in Delhi who were carrying out all this. They were paying money to people who were working here. Even Delhi police, I believe, the Delhi police in my security, was being paid for information by the Haryana group. So it's a total breach of faith. And I put this to Mr. Chandrasekhar and said that we are very hurt. We feel that you don't trust us anymore. And you should take some political action which demonstrates that you are not involved with this and you're willing to take action. Just the suspension of two constables is not good enough. And then, if he does say it was only a question of two constables, was a question of two constables adequate for him to resign?
The President of India dissolved Parliament. A second general election was called within 18 months. Perhaps the Indian political scene reflects perversely the very basis of Hindu philosophy, that nothing is permanent. Not loyalties, not enmities, not friendships. Parivartino iyam sansara. Everything is transient. In politics, everything is expedient. Ekastu nishkasitah. Here retribution is swift. Aparodattah kshamitah. And so is reparation. Only time can bring a perspective of these turbulent years. 2 years that saw three kings. For on the battle-scarred chessboard of Indian politics, the games were daring, the players ambitious, the fortunes historic. A king was mated, a pawn was crowned, a bishop advanced, a rook castled, and a knight vaulted. The prize was power. And as the contenders clashed, the country was divided like never before by both religion and caste. One leaving a trail of communal riots, the other a trail of deaths. Power had extracted its price, and it was the nation that paid.
The rising communalism does cause me fear for India, yet I have a tremendous faith in the people of India, and I know that they are fundamentally secular, and they will not ultimately get drifted.
As India's man of destiny, the wheel was coming full circle. The 1991 elections were underway. The opinion polls predicted Rajiv's victory. Political observers saw his return to power.
The future I see for Rajiv Gandhi can be summed up as follows. He's 46. Time is on his side. I have reasons to believe that history too is on his side. He is maturing. He has time. Above all, he has, I think, a sincerity of purpose and some of the soundest instincts that one has come across in Indian politics for a long, long time. If he obeys those first instincts and doesn't get easily sucked into the system and is forced to make all kinds of compromises, I believe that he has not just a good future, but India has a great future with him.
He is a young man, very young in political terms. So long as he continues in political life, and provided that, God forbid, that nothing terrible happens to him, I believe he will be a future Prime Minister of India, and I'm inclined to believe he will be the next Prime Minister.
Rajiv also prepared for his imminent return to power.
Oh, there is so much to do. Well, first, get the country out of the mess that these last two governments have got the country into. And it is a mess, especially the economy. We've already made a manifesto of action plans. During this period, we've been working very hard on policy issues and how to implement them. So when Congress comes back, we are ready with a package of measures, and we won't start deciding at that time.
Rajiv plunged into his campaign.
These tours were very different in a sense from the tours that we did as Prime Minister. The security was almost non-existent, and where I found it, I tried to remove it.
Stung by the press criticism that he was aloof and inaccessible, Rajiv removed what was left of his security ring.
And that helped getting through to people. It allowed the people to get through to me.
Believing that fate would protect him, Rajiv plunged into the sea of humanity that eagerly engulfed him.
I was with Rajiv from the 1st of May when he started his campaign in Udaipur. It was one of the most demanding things that I have ever done. Rajiv would campaign from morning to night. Very often his campaign for one day would spill over into the next day without any rest. There were many days when he didn't sleep, but I've never seen anybody do it with grace and with a smile on his face the way that Rajiv did it. He had a tremendous response. His personal magic was working with people wherever he went.
Rajiv was mobbed, cheered, overwhelmed by surging men and women who stole his glasses, seized his hands, pulled at his clothes, and reached simply to touch him.
His hands would often be swollen, and there'd be nail marks of people anxiously trying to clutch him and hold on to him, you know, and prevent him from moving on. So it was painful at times, but he recognized it for what it was, which was an abundance of love and affection.
Well, when I see the way people respond, the warmth, the love they shower on me, it touches me very deeply. I feel, well, it does something to me and builds a commitment to try and do something for them.
For 7 years, Rajiv, the man who was rated Z, the highest on the hit list in the country, lived under the shadow of death. But courage and death are related. For true courage always knows that death may be its price.
Getting shot for or killed for what one believes in has never frightened me. It's never bothered me at all.
Rajiv didn't fear for himself at all. I think he believed, in some way, that his security lay in the warmth of the people. That the people that he was with, meeting and interacting with, were not going to do him any harm.
But Sonia was frighteningly aware that all it took was one demented assassin for her world to fall apart. It was now the last lap of the campaign. 72 hours left for the campaigning to end.
We went to Madras, where he arrived quite late, 6 o'clock in the evening. And apart from the airport press conference and things like that, there was just one more engagement for the day, which was this meeting at Sri Perumbudur. He was very elated. I don't think I'd ever seen him as happy and cheerful as he was on the 21st. He was smiling, he was chatting, which he normally did, but you know, it was even more noticeable. And I don't think I'm saying this with hindsight. I think even then I felt that, you know, he's very cheerful and very happy, and I think it's because he feels that a well-done campaign is coming to an end.
In a blazing charge towards victory, flushed and triumphant, Rajiv arrived at the remote town of Sri Perumbudur late on the night of 21st May. But that fateful night, Rajiv's gods deserted him. Waiting for him in the sea of faces was the unknown custodian of his own life, standing, waiting, watching, garland in hand and a bomb in her belt. Rajiv stepped forward to meet the crowds. Vulnerable. Unafraid. Trusting. And it was over. In one brutal, blinding flash, he was gone. Forever. Into the silent darkness. The moment Sonia had dreaded every single day for the last 7 years had now become a reality. The walls of Teen Murthy, which once echoed with his childhood laughter. Now the same house received the casket of the third generation of the Nehru family. He watched, silently, as yet another brave child was brought home, martyred at the altar of the nation. Did he wonder at the injustice of fate that relentlessly claimed sacrifices from his family? For 3 days and nights, Sonia kept vigil beside her lost husband and her memories.
I met Sonia for the first time in Cambridge. From the first time I saw her, I knew that, well, she was the girl for me, and then we fell in love. We had very long talks, my wife and I, before I left flying and I joined politics. She was never happy about it. Mainly because she felt that, in a sense, she would be losing me.
Outside, the world wept. For the loss of the past, for the loss of the future, for Rajiv, for themselves, and the ravaged family.
What is what's very difficult is what the children have to go through. They really have to go through a very difficult period. And if anybody really has had to sacrifice, it's been the children.
Seven years ago, they came in thousands with a new hope to cheer Rajiv in his hour of victory. came again today, 7 years later. The same people, for the same man, but this time to mourn him on his last journey through the city he loved. Each building stood silent today, and yet, 7 years ago,
I, Rajiv Gandhi, do solemnly affirm. भारत को एक नई शताब्दी के लिए तैयार करना है.
The nation listened, and the world listened.
I am young, and I too have a dream. I dream of an India strong, independent, self-reliant, and in the forefront.
शानो यदन्ने नातिरोहतो मेनारामस्य महिमातो ज्यायांश्च पुरुषः पादो यश्वाभूतानि त्रिपादस्यामृतं दिवो त्रिपादूर्ध्वैपुरपादोऽस्यावत्पुनः ततो विश्वमन्यन्यानामसाधनानसनेऽहो
to having to die for what you believe in, I don't hesitate. I don't hesitate. I don't hesitate.
संसार